Perfect. Good evening, everyone. As we near the end of another academic year, specifically in 2 weeks, we're going to be done, Parsons School of Design has the remarkable fortune to host three distinguished speakers in conversation with each other. Parsons represents a unique space in which people and ideas converge. And in some ways, the conversation you're about to witness is a testament to that school's power to bring the most forward-thinking, knowledgeable, and curious minds together. So tonight's talk is very timely. From where I'm standing, today more than ever, our graduates are entering into an industry that's in the midst of change. There is less time to create, as businesses have their foot on the gas pedal to increase the pace of creativity. Fueling binge consumption with reduced time to engage with the customer, the industry finds itself at its current state of unrest. So the three accomplished individuals you're about to hear from this evening are the fashion industry veteran Julie Gilhard, the co-founder, editor, and publisher of Paper Magazine, Kim Hustrider, and then, of course, fashion designer Alber Elbaz. There's no doubt that each of tonight's guests are accomplished beyond measure, but each of them, moreover, is championing the potential of young, emerging talent like yourselves. Our first guest, Julie Gilhard, is a creative business consultant for an influential set of clients. And she has helped launch the inaugural LVMH Prize for Emerging Talent, engaging young, promising designers from all over the world. And in her previous role as a senior vice president at Barney's, where she worked for 18 years, she supported many designers in building their businesses. Including Albert at Lanvin, Alexander Wang, Nicolas Ghesquier at Balenciaga, Ricardo Tisci at Givenchy. And our next guest, Kim Hustrider, co-founded Paper Magazine in 1984 as a black and white 16-page foldout. Today, the paper is a monthly print and digital publication credited by Vanity Fair as having changed the face of pop culture magazines. She is widely renowned for her ability to connect and nurture young artists, designers, and musicians. And finally, Alber Elbaz, born in Casablanca, Morocco, and raised in Israel. In 1985, he left his home to begin working in New York City's garment district, and in 1989 became the assistant to couturier Jeffrey Bean, before taking up the helm at Guy Laroche in Paris, and continued his career as a creative designer for Yves Saint Laurent's Rive Gauche ready-to-wear women's wear line. But best was still yet to come. Albert arrived at Lanvin as a creative director in 2001, and single-handedly revived the brand from scratch, making it one of the most coveted labels with timeless and alluring creations for women.
And got fired after 15 years.
But Albert's work represents a quiet, complicated conception of femininity, seeking to design garments that transcend seasonal fads and can be worn by women throughout their lives. His designs have always been exquisite and thoughtful, but above all, practical. So he once said in an interview, if it's not wearable, it's not fashion. So when I think about what it means to be a designer in today's world, I remember Albert's word, we became creative directors, so we have to create, but mostly direct. And now we have to become image makers, making sure it looks good in the pictures. And loudness is the new thing. Loudness is the new cool. I prefer whispering. I think it goes deeper and lasts longer. So today we wait to hear with bated breath what's next in store for Albert. So join me in welcoming Albert, Kim, and Julie to Parsons as they recount their stories from their past, as well as sharing insights into the future of the industry.
standing.
Okay.
Barack, those chairs are not comfortable. I'm here.
Reorganizing.
We need to redecorate a little.
Preface this before Albert starts to talk. Kim and I have known Albert for over 20 years. And we both fell in love as a friend, but have also traversed the many ups and downs of the fashion business in the last 20 years. So it's pretty interesting for us to look out on this like group of mostly students and to see that, wow, you know, get ready for the ride. So, I've had the opportunity to meet every single designer, really, that's that you know or study, that is living, and I can't really count to five the ones that I think have the skill, the imagination, the ability to dream, the craft, the reference to the past, but an eye to the future. So I think the reason for Albert being here, not just as the iconic, legendary designer he is, it's actually the whole picture. And so if we don't listen to these people that are great, then, you know, that doesn't make us great. So I think it's you know, he's going to talk. Kim is also one of the greats. And we'll have a time for questions at the very end, so if you have a question, be thinking about, make sure it's a really good question. And what's in the bag?
You know, after I posted in Instagram the invitation, and it was all happening really kind of by coincidence, I was on the phone with Julie, and I said, you know, I have a free afternoon, and she said, why don't you come to Parsons? Which she says it every time I'm coming to America. I said, you know, why won't I? And I would love to meet some students. And a few weeks ago, I was watching TV. I'm a TV freak. And I saw this program about Isaac Stern, which is a violinist. And he teaches a lot in Juilliard. And he said that every time he teaches, he learns more than he teaches. And since my tragedy, I've been traveling the world. I've been traveling the world, and I meet people, and I meet students. And I was a student, you know, but I was the nerd student because I get stressed about everything. Everything stresses me. You know, when I go out for dinner with people I don't know, I get stressed. When I go with people I know, I get stressed because I'm afraid I'll get out of subject, you know, around the round table. I mean, when I do a collection, I'm stressed. When I don't do a collection, I'm stressed. I'm not the easiest one when it comes to being relaxed and zen. But, you know, when I posted the fact that I'm coming here, the invitation, I read also some of the comments. And the comments of one of the girls, I don't know if she's here, and she said, oh, I'm definitely going to hear Albert. And then she said, make sure you don't forget to bring some tissues. So I don't know if you brought some tissues, but I brought some tissues with me. Just in case, you know. You know, when I go to my psychiatrist, she always have it just in case. So, one second, we have more. By the way, is that girl here? I want to see who she is. That here. Did you bring tissues? Here. Here. But then I thought, you know what? We're living in, especially in fashion, with people that just look at the plate and make it messy. Nobody has sugar anymore. And I think that sugar is a very important thing for the brain, especially when you create. So I brought candies. And you are going to start here, 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 and here. Now you're happy. Here. You go. And who else can pass to the north part? Come on, come over. You see, so now everybody loose and happy. We have tissues, we have candies. Okay. So we passed the Instagram story. I wanted to come actually and to wear the same jacket I wore last night when I went to the Met, and then we had like six parties, you know, the one that you go with the car and it's like, hi, bye. And and I wanted to wear it because I just thought it would be interesting to show you that people think that fashion is one long party that never ends. And I'm not sure about it because I think that fashion is one big party, but it ends sometimes. But it's not sad, it's good. You know that sometime, as I told you before, I'm a bit of a TV freak and I'm watching Project Runway. And when I see Heidi Klum, I mean, she's gorgeous, but when she speaks about one day you're in and the next you're out, I mean, every time I hear it, I don't adjust to that, I'm like nauseous. I mean, just about the idea. And it's almost like a trauma just to have the idea that you can be in fashion in and then you're out. And what does it mean, really? And I believe personally that once you're here, even for a short time, you leave a trace behind. And I'm not talking about fingerprints, because fashion is not a crime scene. Like life, you know, we go through highs and lows. And I came here today without a private driver, without an assistant, without a secretary, without a PR with three phones that tell you where to sit and what to say and where to pose. I came with a friend, with Julie, that came to pick me up. And we met Kim that was waiting for us. So I thought there is something quite fabulous about being free. I was there 15 years, almost 7 days a week, a tuna sandwich for lunch and a pizza for dinner, because there were early morning and long, long night, and never time. I see you're all chewing the candies, I love it. And one day you are out of the system, and you start a new life. But I love fashion. I love fashion people. I like them really a lot. And I really adore this industry. I see it now from a different perspective because I'm an outsider. But now more than ever, I appreciate it more. You know that 6 or 7 months ago, I met Kevin Systrom, the founder of Instagram. I told that story, but I'll repeat. And he asked me if I have Instagram, and I said, not at all. And he said, why? And I said, because I don't have photogenic friends, I only have good friends. But after this tragedy that I was going through, you were laughing, but I was crying. After that tragedy I was going through, I received so many love, I mean, and likes, and I was so touched. It was hundreds and hundreds of those love messages via Instagram, and I decided to join the club. And the first post I've done was to Kevin himself, and I said, I'm sorry, Kevin, I didn't mean it. And I think that you're showing me and you're showing the world that Instagram is also a tool to show love to each other. And last night, I was at the Met, and I saw so many good-looking people, but I saw also so much loyalty and love, and that was something that touched me the most. I went to see the exhibition that Anna did with Andrew Bolton, and I think that you have to run and see this exhibition. It was, do you need a tissue? Who is coughing? And I saw this exhibition, and it was one of my favorite ever. And you know why? Because it was so much about whispering again. It was almost an exhibition that was done for designers and with designers' work. It was about workmanship, about know-how, about time. And the one thing that impressed me the most is the fact that it was almost silent. And I think that maybe Anna and Andrew are pioneering something that is maybe less loud and more silent, and I loved it. And please go and see it. You know that we designers are living like a very, very hard calendar. You know, we're changing the show time, we're going through the show now, where now, I mean, big, big changes. Designers are leaving, designers are coming, a lot of changes. And I'm thinking, what is happening? And someone says about the changes, and I'm just quoting, he said that when there is a wind of changes, we have two possibilities, whether we built a wall to protect us from the wind, or we built a windmill to make the wind go faster so we can take advantage of this wind. I think that technology embraces those changes and they use the wind to go forward. Fashion somehow built a wall and a bunker to protect ourselves and to protect the tradition. The end result is that Johnny Ive from Apple Computer is now the new James Bond of the world. The technology is all about newness, about innovation, future. Technology invented a new word, actually, smart design. Wow, smart design. And I always love the idea of the word smart design. I'm not talking about intellectual, because I'm not an intellectual, and I don't think fashion is anything about being intellectual. I mean, I always said that fashion is like a roasted chicken. You don't have to think when you eat it. Well, I think that what we are embracing, if they're embracing smart design, we are embracing still sexy design. And maybe it's time to move on. There is no industry like fashion industry. We're only, and the only industry that can take just 2 meters or 2 yards of fabrics and create a dream. And we create those dreams with threads, needle, one seamstress, and a fantasy. And I have a beautiful story to tell you about a seamstress. You know, I've been traveling a lot. And I was in Tel Aviv, and I met this woman for the first time who is an art dealer. And she told me that every time she sees my clothes, she thinks of her mother. And I asked her, why is that? And she said, my mother was a seamstress in Auschwitz in one of the concentration camps. But she was the best seamstress in the camp. And since she was the best, the Nazi didn't want to get rid of her. So every time they gave her an extension to live longer, and she survived. And this new friend of mine gave me the thimble that her mother used. And this is what I have to live with, because this is what we do for a living. And what I learned from this story is that when you are good and when you are professional, don't be scared, because nobody can erase you. I'm not here to criticize fashion, and I didn't come all the way to New York from Paris to complain about it, even though I'm known to be a complainer. But I also don't want to trash the system where I belong. But sometimes I have a feeling that we're living in such a transparent world, a world that the buildings are glossy and transparent because they're all made in glass. We're wearing only transparent clothes. We're living a transparent life. And somehow, and sometime, unfortunately, we are acting like transparent people. And that's maybe why we need to make some changes. touring the world, and you know, those tours were not like a rock concert tours. It was just going, meeting people, having lunch, dinner, breakfast, listening to stories, telling stories, seeing the world, understanding what is going on around the world, from America to Europe to Asia. I met so many people, and so many of them told me we're not happy. And it was old-fashioned people. And I'm asking myself, how come so many people in fashion, and which is the best job in the world, we're just, you know, doing the best thing, we're meeting the best people, we're all about beauty, we're all about fantasy. What is it that makes all of us so neurotic and so unhappy? And you know that at one point I wanted to leave fashion and I wanted to learn to be a doctor. And I remember that I read this article about a mother that lost her child. And it was so sad that I had this tear in my eye that didn't come out. And I thought, wow, who cares about fashion? Who cares if this woman is wearing a red dress or a white pants? And later on that week, I thought, maybe for women like that, I have to go and do fashion and work, because my job is to make her life and women's life a little bit easier, a little bit colorful, and a little bit more beautiful. And that's what I do for a living. I'm not a fashion designer, but I try to make women look as just a better version of themselves. I'm not erasing them, but I'm just helping them to be a better version of them. I came to Parsons, and actually I was the one to ask Julie this time to come here, because I wanted to say that design and designers are the essence and the fuel and the foundation of fashion. Fashion without designers is like a home without a mother. We need, now you have to applaud. We need to celebrate design so we can celebrate fashion again. And that's why I took the time to come here to Parsons and meet students upstairs before I came here and just see people and see what they're all about. I think that today school has a great mission and a great importance, you say in English, to move talent forward to the future. A few years ago, I met this wonderful woman, Louise Wilson, that was the head of St. Martin MA program, that was a great, great friend of mine. And she asked me once, Albert, what do you think we should do at the school in London, at St. Martin? Do you have any ideas? And I thought, you know, maybe yes. Maybe I think you should teach how to be famous. And she said, what do you mean by that? I said, I don't know, maybe some film classes or acting or dancing or singing. And we were both laughing, and she said, why do you think? And I thought, you know, because it really helps if you're famous, if you want to do fashion. I mean, imagine you kind of step dancing while you show the collection. I can tell you, I mean, the buyers will love the collection. And I have a feeling somehow that these days, if you hold the camera, I mean, you already consider yourself as a photographer and you're just waiting for MoMA to call you for an exhibition. And if you look great and sexy, you can be a chef and we can open a chain of restaurants in Vegas. And if you're famous, you can just do anything you want, just anything. And now we need... And that's why we need school today, because we have to do two things in this great design school. We have to give the time, and we have to strengthen the muscles. Because muscles and time are two things that you cannot buy in any luxury store. You have to work hard, and you have to train. And this is what school and this is what fashion is all about. I hear also these days, too many times, or too often, shall we say, in better English, like young designer, old designers, I mean, young actress, old actress, I mean, older writer, a younger writer. And I'm like, is it really about being young or old? Or is it about being good or bad? Maybe it's not about being a young designer or an old designer. Maybe it's just about being a good designer or a bad designer. It's very, very easy. And I always say that when I read some of those articles, when they said it's maybe the end of the star system when it comes to designer, I'm getting a rush from nerves. Because it's not the end of the star system. Because you become what you become if you do a good job, and if you work with passion and compassion, and if you have experience. And then you may become famous, but you're not working for being famous. You're working to do a good job, and the end result is being a little bit known. One advice I want to give, especially the students that are here in this room, is that will be, of course, the future of fashion, is that don't try to be fashion catwalk designer. I don't know if Lee Edelcourt made it, but made it here today, if she's here. Hi, Lee, I love you. We have a dinner with Lee that started, I think, around 8 and ended at 2 in the morning. And in my life, as much as I love to eat, I don't spend like 6 hours for dinner. But I did it with Lee. And I learned so much from her vision, her manifesto, her smart, intelligent. And she was talking about, this is not me, it was what I read in the manifesto of Lee about don't be a catwalk designer. Because you make some noise, you're being hired, and everybody loves you, and you're a real hero. And then you don't make the numbers because you're all in extreme. And I think that in order to prevent that, maybe we need to dream, but maybe we need to think. And fashion is not just thinking, or not just dreaming, but is the mix of two. I'm also saying that, remember, not everything has to scream on the screen. Second advice is, and a very important one, I think, that we can no longer photocopy reality because fashion is not a recreation of life. Third, use Google, great, but dream and think afterwards because Google is not the final collection. Google is just the beginning of the process of making your work. And I love Google myself, I'm actually in love. But I think it's creating like such a laziness that it's really dangerous for design. So sometime go and check it out and go from there. And before I'm going to end, just one word about our partners, the designer partners, which is the business side of fashion, business of fashion. It's obvious that designers are around the world, they're a little bit itchy these days. They're very insecure. They're very kind of confused. So much collection. I mean, we are showing too big collection. I mean, the collection are being shown in January and by June. I mean, people always feel that they are buying an old collection. So there are a lot of issues. But there are also a lot of issues, I think, with the business partner we have, which they're also not that happy. And you know why they're not that happy and why it's not easy being them? Because today, a lot of the CEOs around the world are also good friends of mine, and I see what they are going through. So they have a designer that on one hand said, oh, I want to be inspired by Maharaja for winter, and I want white. And they hear white, and their hair is getting white. And then you speak, after they have to speak with the marketing directors, and they will said, we need a three-hole dress, you know. I mean, it has to be like $9.99, and we have to have a black one for New York and a pink for Chicago. And I'm like, okay. And then you speak with merchandiser that need three references in 7 colors, and one of a sudden, I think, 21 references, wow. And then you speak with wholesalers, not me, but the CEOs, and the wholesaler said, we need everything like less expensive. And then you speak with the retailer that said, only expensive sales. And I see those CEOs have to manage all of us. And you know what? If we will have a better communication, a better dialogue with us and the management, that will be the only time when we can make beautiful fashion and a beautiful dream. And I think that if we inject a little bit more love to fashion and less fear, because today I feel that it's more about fear and less love, we will have a beautiful reason to wake up every morning. Thank you. I'm staying here for the questions.
Well, sit in the middle. It's actually hard to...
Ah, okay.
Yeah. Sorry. Can you want to sit or you want to stand?
No, I stand.
Oh, okay. Can I ask, because I'm going to address something that he just talked. Forgive my notes, because I'm like...
Hi, Mark.
It's rare in most any field that a great creative talent can survive financially without a business partner. I'm going to just address what you just spoke about. In the past, in the fashion world, you know, many of the great and most talented and creative designers historically who built successful brands that also have functioned as successful businesses found left-brain partners and true believers, who were often trusted friends or life partners to work with in this endeavor. You know, Yves Saint Laurent had Pierre Berger, Marc Jacobs had Robert Duffy, Miuccia Prada has her husband, Calvin Klein had Barry Schwartz. You know, do you ever think about building a house this way? And how does, you know, like, I just feel like now what's replaced that are, you know, the big companies that act conglomerates that have stepped in to fill this role, which is kind of like more what's happening now. And it can, to partner with a really creative person, it can be a bumpy road. It's because this scenario is more like being an employee than a boss or having ownerships. After your many experiences working for others, do you still recommend putting your heart and life into a company that employs you rather than one that is you have ownership in?
I think that, you hear me, right? I think that whatever we do, you know, in every contract I ever sign, the only page I read inside out and between the line was the page where we talk about freedom of creativity.
Freedom, that's what.
And in the end of the day, it doesn't matter if you work for yourself, it doesn't matter if you work for someone else, it doesn't matter if you own this company or you don't. Whatever you do, you have to do the best you can. And I'm not talking just about being a designer. I think that if you're a secretary, you have to be, or to try, to be the best in whatever you do. If you are a high-tech man, try to put everything into it and be the best. I'm always a little bit more skeptical from mediocre. I mean, people who are just next to thing and not inside. I like perfection, and I totally admire disperfection, but I don't like whatever is in between. I think that partnership, and I think that I'm here also today, and I ask you, Kim and Julie, to be with us today, is because I believe in friendship, because I believe that it gives you a comfort. There is nothing that can kill me more as a designer, as a person, as a creative person, is than politics. You know, I don't deal well with bitches. I mean, I can't. I mean, the moment I work with difficult people, I lose my creativity. The moment I have to think about how to say and not what to say, I'm losing my voice. So I need to be extremely comfortable with the surrounding that I'm in. And I think that this was always the studios that I always created. It was studios with many doors, but the doors were open. There were no walls. And people came and people talk and people ask and people got it and people gave it. And this is what life is all about. It's about giving and taking.
But do you see that old model and the new model? I mean, you know that old model of someone who is really a friend and passionate about this person and a human connection that, you know, if I had like a left brain instead of a right, which I don't have, like I would be your CEO and try and make what you do work, as opposed to try and be a CEO that there's that disconnect.
You know, Kim, you just said the word, the new world and the old world. I mean, with all the changes that we are witnessing now, I think it's great. Even though it's difficult on a daily basis, I think that something really good will happen. I think that something really fabulous will end up because people are questioning. And for too long, we did not question. For too long, we just did what we always did. So the collection will change like 100 times a year, with new collection, and new pre-collection, and new post-collection, but the system always remained the same. It's almost like advancing with like high-tech, I mean, fabrics, and then you see that you can dry only cotton and silk. So one of a sudden, all those fabrics are being manufactured by those amazing companies, and you are like, wow, this is a modern fabric. When you take it to a dry cleaner, they're like, sorry, we can't do it. So I think that if you do actually collaborate and work together, and it's a process, it's not going to happen overnight. Because we, especially in fashion, I think we invented that rapidity that we think like, oh my God, let's lose weight. I mean, I'll be amazing, I'll reach, and I'll marry a billionaire, and I'll move to Beverly Hills. And it doesn't happen. Because it takes so long to reduce weight and to lose weight. I mean, so it takes time. And this is the one thing that we don't give to each other, time. And every other industry, you know, like they are doing a movie and they take the time and then the actress is like resting for a year and a half. And we in fashion, I mean, we finish like the collection, we're half dead with like herpes all over the face. And they're like, we are late with next collection. I'm like, what do you mean? And they're like, you need to have the fabric by this weekend, otherwise you will not have collection for the next show. And you're like, wow. And you have to do it. And it's not about the hours and it's not about being tired, but it's about, we're not computers. Designers are not just machines that you press a button and said, be creative on Tuesday afternoon. Because, you know, one of those things is that sometimes we are and sometimes we're not, and we have to face this blank page, and we are facing it, and we are scared when we are not, we cannot feel it. And I remember speaking with one teacher also in one school, maybe in Belgium, and I asked her, like, how come, like, fashion students spend so many hours in school? You know, you see, like, medical school, architect, like, by 5, they're already, like, in New Jersey. We in fashion, like, midnight, and you are not done. You're just beginning the project. And I saw today at Shelley's course, I mean, they have, like, sugar and chocolate and candies, and I'm like, wow. And she said it's for those white knights. And I'm saying that we in fashion, we don't have that library that doctors or lawyers goes and they have the question and they have to just find the book and then the book will tell them what to do. We have to experience it. We don't have anyone that will tell us where to find and what to find. So time grows.
So Albert, so you talk about like the system of fashion and that, you know, it's not just 2 collections a year, but it's 6. And it's not just women's for a lot of people, it's men's and women's, and it's accessories, and it's shoes, and it's perfume. So you started with Jeffrey Bean, you went into Guy LaRoche, you did a magnificent job at Yves Saint Laurent, and then you ended up recreating the house in Lanvin. So the difference between when you started and now is that there's a lot more to do and the pace is much faster. Mm-hmm. So if you were a student back at, you know, where you were, but it was, you know, 2016, what would be your game plan?
I will, first of all, every project I take as a student, before running the marathon, you know, that endless marathon we run and we lose no calories, I will sit and I will think. First of all, I will think, because I think that smart design is the new thing. And it's not just about gorgeous, but it's also about being functional. It's also about being smart. It's also about listening to people's need. And we can no longer just like create needs, you know, that are being told by those marketing people. They tell you, we need this, we need that. But it's maybe listening to consumers themselves, and maybe also is creating needs that they didn't know they needed. Mm. These are the most difficult thing to do, because, you know, we always talk about fashion. We are like talking about atelier. I wish I did not work now in an atelier, but I would work in a laboratory when people are thinking, when people are brainstorming, when there is a think tank of people that put together ideas and question, and then you start the creative process.
So that kind of being said, now, the whole idea of the buy now, wear now,
it's an interesting thing, only because it's a change. And, you know, there is a story with the two mouses in the glass of milk, and there is one mouse that doesn't do nothing. She just, like, stands, and she drowns. And the other one is, like, screaming and moving till that milk turns into butter, and then she floats. I think that what is happening today is that we are, like, making noise about everything, and everything is an issue, and we're changing the calendar, and we're doing show now, wear now, and we're doing men and women all together, and we're also, like, I mean, planning deliveries in a different way, and there's so many things, but it's okay. I think it's exactly the process, and I'm sure every student here that is working on collection, we know that in the beginning of every process of design, we just throw ideas, and then you do editing. So I think that now we're in the process of throwing ideas on the table, and whatever work will actually live. And like in evolution in the world, whatever doesn't work will die.
And it's individual. I mean, everyone's not the same.
I think so. Individuality is a very, very, very good thing. Again, I mean, that's the name of the game. We shouldn't try to be like everyone. You know, there is this feeling sometimes that if there is a pizza in that street and there are a lot of customers, let's do another pizza next to it. And I'm like, no. I mean, if there is a pizza, maybe open like H&M next to it. I mean, because, you know, the people will come in and eat after they shop, or Uniqlo. I mean, I love Uniqlo. So,
but I'm fishing for like where, like, all designers aren't the same. So some designers thrive on doing, like, you know, 30 collections a year, and some are like an Azzedine Alaya, you know, or everyone's different. And I'm trying to fish from you, where are you? Like, what do you, have you learned from your experiences, and where do you fit? Do you feel more akin to, you know, someone, to being smaller and being more familial, or do you...
You know, Kim, I'm always on diet, but I want to have, like, McDonald's, you see? So
right.
I'm like a man of contradictions.
Okay.
And even here, I think that on one hand, I'm totally, totally attracted by the mass market and by high street. But I think that sometimes high street and high fashion are both in high. So maybe it's time to come down. And I think that there is something in high street when I see people like walking, and I see couple in love, and I see the urge of shopping, and a lot of cosmetic company, because everybody wants to look gorgeous in Instagram. So, I mean, those cosmetic companies are like booming. This is one. And on the other hand, you know, since I left, I can't sketch. I mean, I still have a huge scar on me, so I cannot sketch, but I write ideas. And I remember when I left, I mean, for the first couple of months, I was walking in Paris. It was raining every day, and it was pouring rain, but I was walking and walking and walking and thinking, and I never knew when I touched my face if it was the rain or my tears. So I think that also now I have to feel like going back to fashion, but to put and to make exquisite clothes, to make beautiful, beautiful, beautiful coats, and to make gorgeous shirts and to work with women individually and to know the people and to know the person in front of you. So it's not that anonym anymore. And again, I spoke before about the fact that we're living somehow in a world of transparency and we turn into transparent people because we are like everybody else and there is something generic. And I want to touch the two. I would love very, very much on one hand to work and to touch, I mean, this world of High Street because there is this beautiful energy going on. And next to it, I would love to make those clothes for women I love and I would love to do it only with people I love.
And, you know, you are so, you know, one might think you're not commercial, but you are so beloved. I mean, in one day when this was announced, 1,200 people RSVP'd. I mean, you are beloved by, you know, many, many people. So in a sense,
I think, Kim, that when you love people, people love you back. And when you don't like people, people don't like you either. So, you know, I was having dinner with a friend of mine in Paris, and we talked about almost everything, everybody in fashion. And at 11, it wasn't as long as the dinner I have with Lee, we thought, my God, we talked about so many people, and we said mostly good things about them. And you know what? You come home and you feel good. You don't feel that you have to take a shower to get like, ugh, I'm so disgusted. No, it was good. It was fabulous. I mean, we talked about people we love, about good work they're doing, about new adventure. So I think, you know, it sounds always good on stage, you know, like be positive. And then we come home and you're like so negative. But it's one of those things that I believe that you have to do things with joy and that joy will come back. And maybe we are somehow not in a momentum of too much joy. And we have to experiment that to bring back, you know, this creativity and happiness and joy and fun. Because, hey, what is it that we do? I mean, we do clothes. I mean, we're not like, you know, inventing the wheel here. But we have to make it beautiful. We have to understand the people we work for. We have to understand the language of the people that we're communicating. So this is what we're doing.
Yeah. Do you have a...
So when you can do, I mean, I
feel like we're in the White House. I love it.
We asked for a table, but I forgot to say size. But you can do the mass, and you can do the haute couture because you're a good designer. So
I'm experienced. I'm not sure. I will leave the judgment if I'm good or bad to fashion critique and fashion director and buyers. I'm just an experienced designer that does. That's the only thing I know how to do. You know, I don't even know how to drive.
Well, let's just.
So.
Let's just say that you're a designer that can design beautiful things that sell. So really, that's it.
You know what it is, Julie? I mean, I have a feeling that sometimes, and that's maybe the one thing that scares me the most, I almost feel that ugly is the new beautiful. And I'm not into that. I feel that beautiful is beautiful and it's timeless. And this is, for me, the only definition of modernity. And ugly is ugly, but you can like ugly, which is okay. And maybe ugly is a reflection of the time. So I'm not surprised that there is so much ugliness. Now you got it.
That was a positivity.
So I'm a student out there, and I'm thinking, okay, what do I need to really learn? Because I have this thing called my phone, and I have this thing called Instagram, and I can make it look however, which way I want, or I can do a little film, and it's super cool. And so there's to me, that's a scary thing, because I don't think that there's enough study. Like, everything you say is, how long were you at Jeffrey Beam for?
8 years.
So do you sat at that desk every day?
Next to him, yes.
For 8 years.
For 8 years. So, but every day I thought it's my last day, they'll be firing me. You see, so.
Why?
I was always packed, you know, my thing, just in case, you know.
So.
I'm used to be fired, you see.
I don't know how many of you all know Jeffrey Beam, but if you don't know him, study him. He's one of our greatest American designers.
Ever.
A designer, he could have been an architect, but he just fell into fashion. He knew.
That's how I met Kim, because
I met Albert, because I was friends with Mr. Bean, who was, you know, the most incredible designer. And he somehow took to our little rag paper, downtown rag, when it was a black and white, you know, we were doing it out of my house. He wrote me a letter, and that's how I met him. And he invited me to lunch, and his, at first, when I met him, Richard Lambertson, who designs for Tiffany's, right? Or does he do? Richard Lambertson was his assistant, and I met Richard. So he would always take his assistant to lunch. And then one day, Richard was no longer there, and Albert was there, and he was Mr. Bean's new assistant. And this was 25 years ago. And so every month, we would have lunch at the Odeon. And that's how I met Albert. And Albert was Mr. Bean, would carry his credit card, right? And Mr. Bean was a strong spice, to put it mildly. But he was an incredible designer. He was brilliant. And he loved Albert. Mr. Bean's,
and I loved him.
And Mr. Bean would not, his assistants, he could torture you, his assistants. And they wouldn't often be there for that long. But Albert was there forever. He loved Albert. Albert made him laugh. I always said Mr. Bean was a very reserved, waspy man, and he always loved kind of loud Jewish people. And I always, which, hello, I'm one. And Albert, right? He loved
one. So the lesson there is when the going gets tough, you know, you don't leave.
Well, also I wanted to ask Albert a bit about mentorship, because I think that Mr. Bean was a mentor to you, and I wanted you to maybe relay just the funny first story of how you arrived there at Mr. Bean, you know, at Mr. Bean's studio, and how he took you in, and what did you learn from him?
You know, it's a very, very beautiful time for me also when I came to America. And, you know, it's not like to New York, but you come to America, the dreamland, when things can happen overnight. And I met Mr. Bean, which for 2 years, you know, I was trying to get that job. But the amazing receptionist told me in June to call in the winter. In the winter, she said, call in the summer. So she pulled me, now we're best friends. But at the time, that was, you know, you could not get over the receptionist. And, you know, when you don't, you're not like 6 feet two tall of muscles, and you're not like a hunk, you know, like doing like this in interviews. I mean, you don't always get a job. And I was not graduated at Parsons or at the Royal College or any other great school. So you have to do everything by yourself, and you have to find ways to get through. And but it was also the time that when we graduated school, we didn't become creative director. You see, we took the time to learn. And what you do learn in with your mentor, and I had two of them, the most important was Jeffrey Bean, and then I have Yves Saint Laurent. So I had two of very, very, very good and influential and creative people of the 21st century that I learned from. And we take the time to learn and to know and to move on afterwards, because you learn from their mistakes and you learn from their strength. And I remember when I entered Jeffrey Bean the first week, he happened to be gone because he had like a cataract, you know, operation. So I was by myself and they didn't know where to put me. So they just like said, okay, you can maybe work in the dressing room. So I was like, okay. And there was no table. There was a chair and a gloss table on the floor, kind of like a coffee table. And I had to sketch, and I sketched. And I see Mary Lou here, that was one of Mr. Bean's amazing friend as well. And I was sketching for like 14 hours a day and sketch. And I remember on the Friday, just before Mr. Bean arrived, his main assistant came over and said, let me see what you're doing. And I showed him and I said, what do you think? He said, that's not at all Jeffrey Bean. And again, I packed my bag, you know, I thought, okay, I mean, let me just wait for being let go on Monday. And Mr. Bean arrived, and I just wanted to hug him. And he looked at all my sketches, and I had a pile, and he said, give this to Charlie, give this to Carmelo, and this to Carmelo, and this is to Charlie. And I was told later that it was the first time that he actually used so many sketches of a newcomer, I mean, thing that just arrived. And that lesson was to me that when you work for others, don't try to be them. Remain you. You're running. You're okay? I'm not too boring?
No.
So I'm saying when you go and you work for other people, don't try to say, okay, so now I work for Alexander Wang, so let me be Alexander Wang. No, be you and let him be him, so he will take the best and make it almost like an alchemistry of two things that become a third that is better than ever.
Albert, have you mentored? I know that, you know, have you passed that on? Have you mentored anyone that has, you know, flown the nest and become, you know, really a talent that you thought was really talented?
You know, I had many, many great, great people in the studio through the years, and they're in the best places all over the world. And I know that if I will ever come, ever, I don't know, but if I will ever come to live here in New York City, which I'm absolutely loving, but if I will ever, whatever, whenever I find an interesting job that will make me want to wake up again, I know that I will teach. Every Friday, I will take a few hours to teach, and every Tuesday, I'll go and work in a hospital because I'm hypochondriac. So.
Well, it's funny because I don't know if you remember, but we were both having a bad day at work. And I think you asked me, what would you do? And if you didn't do what you were doing, I'm like, I don't know. I hadn't thought about it. And you wanted to work at Saint Laurent. And so you did. You got your dream. But what's interesting to me is that I just assumed that was going to be your end game. And you were going to create this amazing thing like Yves Saint Laurent had. But you didn't. You know, there was a business transaction, takeover, whatever. And you are sort of...
You can say it. I was fired there as well.
But it was a hostile takeover. And then you... How did you land at Lanvin? And how did you... You really created your own house. It wasn't a pre-existing structure there.
There are no formula, Julie. I think that when you are with a group of people that make you happy to see every morning, the sky's the limit. But I don't want to speak about Lanvin.
So on that note, it's just really about the idea of just dreaming, really?
Dreaming and thinking. I think that this is the new thing. Because before, couturier used to be like, Marilyn Monroe in an acid party. Oh, so grand, you know? And I think that these days somehow are over. Because it's not just about dreaming. We're living in a world of yes marketing and yes merchandising and yes business. And it's here to stay. We cannot say we don't give a damn about it. We have to. But I think it's about a balance. I think it's a balance between the two. And to say, okay, I need to think and I need to dream. And it's the mix between the right and the left side of the brain.
So you don't always have to be doing.
Yeah.
Do you want to take some questions?
Yes, with pleasure. If you have any questions. After you have some candies, I mean.
There has to be questions.
Where are you?
If you guys have questions, maybe come down and can talk into the microphone so everyone can hear.
Hello, good afternoon, everyone. My name is Oliver Hunt, and I wanted to say it is an honor for all of us fashion students to be here today. I have a question, and that is, as a wonderful author of these amazing accomplishments, such as revitalizing one of the biggest names in fashion, such as Lanvin, What do you think is necessary to breathe new life into something that is considered obsolete or lost in the past?
Okay, I said before that, remember when I said that when we come to places, I mean, we leave a trace, but it's not a fingerprint because fashion is not a crime scene. Remember that, right? I'm saying that it's very, very important for us to be inspired by tradition, by history, by the past. I think it's great. This is what we actually do in fashion. We're not inventing always like a new sleeve or a new shoulder. But the whole trick is not to take it from the research to the runway. The whole trick is to make it relevant to 2016, to make it relevant to today's women that are running the world. I mean, that can be mothers and they can run the world at the same time, because the history of women was always like either we're a mother or we work. And now I think that women are going through this phase that they can do both. Because, you see, if I was a producer in Hollywood, I think that the James Bond will be a woman, and I will call her Jane Bond. And I think that the whole thing here is to get inspired, but then you have to manipulate it. Then you have to take off. Then you have to add. Then you can take a dress from 1950, but make it in leather. Take off the sleeve, and it becomes a jacket. Add those kind of metal magnet and it become a bit high tech. Take off the back and put it with a t-shirt base and one of a sudden it become conceptual. So in the end of the day, you know where it comes from, but nobody else will know the secret.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
I have to say, Barack, I love my voice with this thing.
I got a question. My name is Theo from New York.
Where are you?
I'm over here. They told me to come down. That's crazy. I have a question. So what's the most nerve-wracking thing that's like happened to you right before like one of your big shows? Because I know you had a lot, but if you could think about one moment, what's the most nerve-wracking thing that has happened or gone wrong?
Well, it doesn't take much to make me a rat. You can tell. But everything, you know, like you finish a show, you work on it for few months, you have a lot of white nights of doubts. I think doubts is not to be sure of yourself, because I mean the world is full of people that think that are like amazing. I don't think I'm amazing. I am always doubting. And you do start, and then you have, you know, to stimulate all your team, and you have to inspire them, and then you have to motivate them. And you know, my team were never like Venice. You know, because to do Venice is so easy. I mean, you just go to Venice and you buy 3 books and you have the show. But it was so much more complex than that. And how to explain something that is a little bit more conceptual into making real clothes. But every stage from having the right idea to finding the right fabrics, to give the right pieces to the atelier and work on the volume, and make sure that you sit there, because fashion is like one big kitchen. It's not like a living room or like some sort of a private jet with a remote control. Then you're like, did you get my instruction? You have to be in the kitchen. You have to sniff, smell. Don't sniff drugs, but smell the food. and this is what it is all about. And then you have the show. And you know, with many, many other businesses, they do what they do and they take the time and then they present it. With us, fashion, we know we finish the collection like on the 99 hour, and every piece come together, and then all the models arrive, you know, to Paris from Milan, and all of them are sick, and everybody kisses you, and then they tell you, I'm so sick, and then you get all the germs, and then... And then you go the next day and you present, and you don't know if it's going to work. And you don't know if your vision is going to take life. And then you wake up the next day. I mean, before, I mean, everybody goes to a party day of the show. I used to go home and get so depressed, and I woke up in the morning and I'm like, oh my God, I'm not feeling well. And everything I did, I only see the mistake. I never saw anything good, you know? So it's not always easy being me. And only now, in a perspective of time, I'm looking at things I've done, and I'm like, you know what? It wasn't too bad. You know, it's like sometimes when I look at myself in photos, I mean, when I was like whatever age, I look and I'm like, ugh. And now when I look at myself when I was like younger, I'm like, I wasn't that fat. You know?
Thanks, I feel you.
You know what I mean.
One last question, yeah. I go through that sometimes.
Hi. I actually was...
Are you enjoying it here?
Let's go. Yeah.
Honestly, me too.
Sorry, I was so excited to come here and ask you questions, of course, you know, about, you know, advice you give to a young designer in New York, and then just being here, I just thought, really, I wanted to say something to you, which is just what a gift you are, and not only an incredible designer, but also an incredible person. And if there's anyone in these changing times who can kind of stand against the frivolity of sometimes what can seem to be fashion, it would be you. And so I'm so excited to see whatever it is that you create next, because it's...
Come, give me a hug. Sorry.
Hello.
Oh, okay. Okay. Other than fashion, what movies do you like to see, and what books do you like to read?
I tell you the truth. When I work, when I'm working on collection, I don't listen to music, and I don't watch movies, and I don't read, because everything influences me a lot. And I have to almost put myself in a bubble. And the only thing I'll be watching and listening will be like CNN, you know, this kind of catastrophe channel. So I'll feel like so happy I'm not like in this, zone. And music really can make me change, I mean, everything. I mean, I'm more inspired personally, not by images, not by flea markets, and not by by visual. I'm more inspired by words. Words and stories are really taking me away. That's why I always enjoy when journalists ask me for an interview. And it's not because I want to be famous, and it's not because I needed... you know, for the world to have more exposure of me. But I really enjoy this dialogue with journalists that are the people that are translating shapes and color into words. So I never read any interview I have done. I never read any good critique. I only read bad critiques. And then I read the line, between the line, under the line. I hate the person who gave it to me. I ignore them for a year, and then I forgive. Yeah.
Hi, my name is Victoria. I'm from Brazil.
What's your name?
Victoria.
Beautiful name.
Thank you. So I wanted to ask you. You talk about this, the whole fashion crazy, and the whole everyone is coming out, and everyone's coming everything together. And I used to work for Vogue Brazil, so this crazy of everything has to be like ready for 3 days ago, and don't sleep, everything. And when Ralph left Dior, Susie from Vogue UK, she wrote an article saying about that how creative designers don't have time to create. They don't have time to see what's going on and what's going on in the world, see exhibitions and all the things, because they have to do 100 collections in 10 minutes and they have to show. So I was wondering, what is your opinion with the whole thing about the slow fashion, and because I think you're kind of a person that could do that, like do have your label and and create the things in your time and only beautiful pieces that you want
to
show.
Okay, to make a long, long story short, I cannot disagree with Susie. I mean, I love her, I know her, I admire her. She's a true, true designer, supporter. I mean, Susie goes to the big houses and Susie goes also to young designers where not many people makes it. And it can be like 105 degrees or it can be 0 degrees and Susie is there. So respect, and I take whatever she said, and yes, you can clap. I wish we could take those clap and put it into Instagram because she loves Instagram.
Thank you.
Oh, hey, my name is Matt.
Where are you?
Here. Who and what gives you the most purpose in fashion or in just life?
I think, wow, that's, you know, when I work today with the students upstairs, I mean, I ask, okay, what was the inspiration? They said, oh, my mother. And I don't know on that one, because I think that sometimes inspiration, it's something that should remain yours. And it doesn't matter where you took it. It matter what you made out of it. It's like with people, it doesn't matter to me ever where they're coming from, but where they're going to. You know, when I did a lot of interviews, and I did many, many through the years, I mean, and it's very easy, you know, to get a portfolio, and they're like, you know, should see her. Her father is so important. I never look at that. I never see these people because her father is important. I see her because I want to see if she's good. And that was always my motto, to find people that I didn't care where they're coming from. I didn't care if they came from grade school or not. But what I see is the work, the brain, and the heart. And I want to see who is it, the person that I can enjoy coming every morning and make mistakes together, because making mistakes is maybe another thing that I will consider as the essence of creation. Because you cannot be sure about what you do, but you have to make mistakes in order for things to happen. Thank you.
Good evening, Mr. Elbaz. My name is Annalisette. I'm from Berlin. And a while ago, I saw the trailer for the Karin Rothfield documentary. And at 1:40,
for
the Karin, what do you say in American? Karin Rothfield. In German, you say Karin Rothfield.
Ah.
Karine.
Okay.
So that's many versions of it now. But I know at 1:44, there's you saying she's a true dreamer. And
who, Karine?
Yes.
She is.
And I never forgot this because I send it all to all my friends, you know, YouTube link, email. 1:44, listen to him. That's the spirit. And I woke up today and I thought, okay, so he thinks about dreaming, so there are still people out there thinking about dreaming, and maybe I should show him some respect today. And I woke up and I was late to work and I didn't have time to shower. And then I thought, never mind, let's show some respect, like shower, run late to work. And then I met my friend waiting in line, and I said, oh, how was your day? And like, oh, mine was really tough. I was late, didn't shower. And she said, I didn't shower. And I was like, oh, really, you didn't? She said, yeah, I mean, he's French. And I thought, okay, wait, but he's not
Thank
really
you,
French.
Thank you, darling.
I know. But I asked myself, well, what do you identify as?
What do you
as?
Want to ask, if I was showering before coming, or what is the question?
I'd love to know, but I was thinking, what do you
identify? I did in the morning.
No, but do you identify as French or European or world citizen? What is it?
About shower?
About nationality.
I mean, I've been asked many questions. That, I mean, first time, first serve. Let me think about an answer. You know what? I mean, let me... You know, I always said, I mean, here, I give you one. I always said that I'm sure that perfume was invented in Paris, but deodorant in America. How is that?
I'll take it as a
Thank
world
you.
Citizen.
I'd rather not go deeper with this kind of question okay. here.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Hi.
Hi.
Can you hear me? Okay. My name's Samantha. It's not a shower question, but
there was an original one. Yes, I have to say.
I was wondering what your first childhood memory was of when you believed that you were going to be a designer.
You know what? Since I was a kid, I mean, really, like, I think in Instagram I posted some of those sketches when I was a kid. You can actually follow me. My numbers are not that high. So you can follow, just if you want. But I was always sketching since I remember myself, but I didn't sketch fashion, you know, since the beginning. I always sketched women and stories, and I remember that one time they called my mom to school because they said that I'm a very good student, and I kind of like, I'm there, but I always sketch. And my mother asked, maybe leave and see what will happen. And that's what happened in the end. You see, this is what I'm all about. And when I was a kid, we lived in a very small neighborhood of a lot of immigrants, and it wasn't anything glamorous. It was not Switzerland, if you know what I mean. And you know, we kind of were surrounded by blue-collar workers, and you will think they will make fun of some sort of fatso sketching women, but they never did. They always told me, one day you'll be a big designer. I don't know if they meant big as designer or big as size.
I think we have time for one more question.
Okay. Hello, my name is Tala. I'm French-Lebanese, but I grew up in Paris. And I wanted to ask you, as like a designer whose career has been, you know, through, like, you know, you've been to various places, I imagine. And where do you think would be, like, the best place to, like, what's the best place to foster new creative talent? Is it still, like, Paris? Is it New York? Where can young designers go where they will be more accepted?
You know, I mean, your generation, I mean, more than me even, you know, you live with internet and with Facebook and social media, so we can do those virtual trips so easy today. We don't have to go to Czech Republic to taste their food. You see, we can see it, we can find a restaurant wherever we live, and I think that in the end of the day, you can be anywhere you want, and it doesn't matter where you are, it matters with who you are. Because sometimes you can be in such a great house, I mean, and everything is so amazing, and the food is so to die for, and the view is like out of the world, but you're sitting with like three people with an attitude bigger than the world, and you know, when the worlds are not coming out because you're so intimidated. And sometimes you sit and you're like with people that are nice and simple and easygoing. And can I tell you one thing? I mean, from my experience, those people that are divas and are very, very difficult to deal with, usually they're not the best. Mm-hmm. I mean, people that are good in what they do, they don't play games. So let's not play game. Let's be easy. Let's have fun. Let's do some mistake. Let's enjoy the moment. And I have to run because I have an event at 7.
Thank you.
Thank you.
You were.
Can you turn off my mic?
Thank you.
I need a mic.
Thank you.
Okay, wait, I have one more thing to say. Oh, thank you. I have one more thing to
go,
say.
Go.
Okay. They turned my mic off. Last but not least, I know that every person in the world, Albert, wants to know what you will do next. And I also know that everybody probably has an opinion about what they think you should do next. And I'm sure many people have already told you what their opinions are. Well, as a surprise for you today,
We thought it would be fun to ask every person here tonight to write their opinion of what should Alber do next in 8 words or less. You've all been given pieces of paper when you came in, and all 600 of you. We will gather these slips of paper from everyone as you leave the building and send them up to you before you leave town tomorrow so you'll have some fun reading material for the airplane. So everyone, please don't forget to deposit your ideas in the boxes you'll see the ushers holding when you leave, just for fun, okay? We have a few minutes left, so who thinks, do we have time for anybody to? If anybody has anything in 8 words or less they think Alber should do next, quick, fast. What? Mary Lou.
Mary Lou. Educate.
Loud.
Educate. Mentorship. I think he should have his own television show.
Yeah. Okay. Next. Next.
Just be you,
the rest
will come.
What?
Just be you, the rest will come.
That's a good one.
Make me your assistant.
So me on my book.
Thank you, of course. Yes. Let me have a job first, darling. Thank you. Do you have any connections with the press people?
Parsons. Also run for president, please.
Don't take me there. I don't like vacation. I hate the beach. I hate the sand. I hate the heat. I'm really enjoying work. Work for me is vacation. So I want to be in vacation.
Alber has to run. So everybody, let's hear it for Alber. But please give your 8 words or less, please. We want him to have a really fun airplane trip back. So write down fun stuff and hand in your papers. That's your homework. Ha ha ha.